And then I was in Phoenix working. Love going to Phoenix in the summer because it's hot, super hot. And if you're depressed, you can go out to a park, sit down, and just watch little kids burst into flame. I go to the club that night to do my show, and the club owner comes over to me, and he goes, hey, Titus, I got to warn you about something. And please never start a conversation with me like that, because my inner retard clicks on and goes, it's cancer. They told him to tell you. I go, what? And he goes, Nils Lofgren is coming to the show tonight. Oh, stop. Nils Lofgren, E Street band Nils Lofgren, one of the best guitarists of all time, is coming to the show tonight. Yeah, I guess you suck so bad at comedy, you've turned it into a rock and roll club. Why is Nils Lofgren coming to the show? I don't know. He called, said he wanted to come see you. Oh, even better, dude. You get to suck in front of one of your heroes. Hey, cue armpit sweat now. But for whatever reason, the show goes great. I have a killer show. I get done. I'm backstage. Waiter comes back and goes, hey, Titus, Nils Lofgren asked if he could come say hi to you. And I don't like meeting celebrities. Do not want to meet them. Don't care. Don't want. You know why? What if they're not cool? What if they're not what you like them for, right? What if they're different? I have this theory called douchebag credits. Listen up. Every celebrity has earned a certain amount of douchebag credits. Tom Hanks has the most douchebag credits. Here's what I mean. If tomorrow's paper read, Tom Hanks punches nun, your first question is, what the hell did that nun do to Tom Hanks? Like a couple years ago, Charlie Sheen cashed all his in a weekend. He was like, winning Tiger Blood, rah, rah. But very brilliantly, Alec Baldwin kind of doles one out every 18 months. That's why you never hate Alec Baldwin. He never lets his balance get down too low. You just go, oh, fucking Alec Baldwin. I guess he's hosting Saturday Night Live again. So, like Lindsay Lohan, bankrupt. But remember Robert Downey Jr. was bankrupt? Now he's back on top again, right? You know? Okay, so you can get him back. And I really don't want to meet him. I'm a fan of this guy, man. I've seen him on the E Street Band concerts on the 70-foot screen playing guitar with his face, doing these crazy solos, doing a backflip. The dude is a rock and roll Godzilla. He comes backstage, he's this tall. And I felt like Willy Wonka for a second. Right. Who's got a golden ticket? By the way, we're friends now and he hates that joke, but what's he gonna do, punch me in the knee? He hates that joke a lot worse. So, just so you guys know, nicest guy in the world. You know, Dana Carvey told me something a long time ago. He said, the nicest people you'll meet in show business are the most talented. And this guy, the most zen-like, he just gives it up. He goes, dude, you great show, funny, great to meet you. You know, my wife and I didn't even know about you, but it turns out Bruce and Patty are fans. Bruce who? Because there's no way he's talking about that guy, and he starts laughing, and I'm not laughing. He goes, why don't you come to our show in LA in a couple of months? And I said, cool. Because the one thing I know about everybody in show business, we're always honest, we're always truthful, we do exactly what we say we're going to do. So I said, see you in LA. But my dad raised me mob style. You don't take favors from people. You do favors, but you don't take them. And then he taught me how to shoot an informant. So my plan is I'm gonna buy my own tickets, go to the concert, be that guy. Oh no, I respect you guys too much. I wanted to pay for my own tickets. But they sold out. So now what do I do? Well, you do what you did. You bitch up like a seventh grade girl and call Nils Lofgren. And I called him, I go, Nils, hey man, I said, I tried to get tickets. I didn't want to bug you, but you said I could come. Let me buy them though. Give the money to charity. He's this guy. Dude, just shut up. I'll call you back in 4 days. 4 days later, I'm in my car driving. My phone rings. I pick it up. It's a woman. She goes, hi, is this Christopher Titus? I go, yeah. She goes, hi, this is Patty Springsteen. Patty Scalfa Springsteen? She goes, yes, you know my name. Rumble Doll Patty Scalfa Springsteen? She goes, oh my God, you know the album too. You can't just call me. You have to have three people call me to warn me that you're gonna call me. Then I gotta make a appointment, get a Ritalin prescription, take some Ritalin, and then you can call me. And she's laughing and I'm not laughing. And she goes, I'm calling because Bruce and I are fans. And I go, Bruce who? Because there's no way. And she's laughing, I'm not laughing. And she goes, we want you to go to the show, but don't go down to the arena to pick up the tickets. Go to our hotel. And I said to her, I said, this is the nicest thing. I can thank you so much. I can't even believe this. This is amazing. Thank you. And I hang the phone up. And my girlfriend is 13 years younger than me, sitting next to me. And I go, that was Bruce and Patty Springsteen. And she goes, Bruce who? No, that's not even funny. In fact, you now have to shut up for the rest of the day unless NSYNC calls you. And we go to this hotel in L.A. on Wall Street. It's one of those hotels we don't get to stay in. It's like, yeah, got gates and a guard tower and a helicopter all the time. You know, it doesn't look like a hotel. There's just a little door in the front, a little tiny name. And you walk in, what the hell is this? And, the Pope would go, damn. And I walk over to the guy, hi, how you doing? Are you the concierge? I speak a little banjo. Do you have something for Christopher Titus? And the guy goes, flip, flip, flip. Nope. Wow, dude, you got punked by Niels Lofgren. Hey, that's still pretty cool, right? And I instantly go into loser mode. I'm like, oh, sorry. And I take three steps, and the guy goes, I'm sorry, Mr. Titus, I do have something for you. It's in the vault. I'll be right back. It's in the vault? The dude comes back with an envelope. I'll never forget it. In the envelope are two tickets, row one, seat 13 and 14, two backstage passes. On the bottom, handwritten, it says PS, which I know means person of suspicion. Because if you knew what a fan I was of these guys, they obviously know what a fan I am. They decided to have security watch my ass all night. But they weren't smart enough. What they should have done is put an exploding GPS tracking ankle bracelet in the envelope that I had to wear, and if I got too close to a band member, it would blow my foot off so they could escape. Don't go! Sign my boom! And my girlfriend goes, P.S. Patty Springsteen, idiot. I told you not to talk. We drive to this concert, and I have to tell you something. I'm telling you this story because if you had it, I'd want to hear it. In my life, whatever I've done, I've never had access like this. We park behind the crew trucks. We go through a back door. We're standing in this little area right off side of the stage, and there's only three couples. It's dark. There's two other couples, myself, my girlfriend, and that's it. And the dude is on stage. One of the best performers of all time is blowing up this arena. And honest to God, it was such a high point in my life, you could have put a bullet in the back of my head, execution style, like my dad taught me. And out of the darkness, the guy comes out. Hey, don't worry. My name's Tony. I'm with the crew. Nice to meet you, Titus. Listen, I'm going to need you to be here during the encore. I got to come get you and take you backstage because Bruce wants to talk to you. And I go, Bruce who? Because there's no way he's talking about that guy. And he doesn't laugh. He just goes, and walks away. Now, if you have not seen the E Street Band in concert, I don't care what race you are, how old you are, what sex you are, go see them. You won't believe it. It's the tightest band I've ever seen. My girlfriend, 13 years younger, she goes, I don't really care. Took her to one concert, two-thirds of the way through, she goes, I would do him in front of you. I know, right? Hell, I might do him in front of you. They're very good. Show's incredible. We get done with the show. Tony comes out of the darkness. Hey, guys, come on back. And he points to the other two couples because we're going backstage, right? And I'm trying to not geek out. I'm just like, I'm just maintaining the thin shred of cool I have. I'm like, And I let them go first because it might be his family, right? As these people walk in front of me, I realize it's the Edge from U2 and his girl and Adam Clayton from U2 and his girl. I turn to my girlfriend. That was the answer of U2! That was the answer of U2! She goes, stop hitting me, I'm filing domestic violence charges. And she's laughing and I'm not laughing. And my inner retard wakes up. Do not speak to the edge. You're gonna say something stupid. Back away from the edge. It is dangerous near the edge. But it's the edge. And I barreled right up to him. How's it going, Mr. The Edge? Oh my God, I can't believe I'm in you. I'm such a huge fan. You guys are devout without being overtly devout. And your music is so inspirational. Oh, dude, when you guys came out with Vertigo, because you keep pushing the envelope, I couldn't believe that album. I didn't know it was you guys. Uno, dos, tres, catorce. What the hell is that, man? You guys are so good. I'm such a big fan. Now, had he stopped talking right there, this would be an amazing story. But dumbass continues on, says one more sentence, and turns it into a phenomenal story. I look the Edge from U2, international superstar, in the face, and I say, dude, I've bought so much of your stuff. I paid for that shirt. And my girlfriend looks at me, turns, and just walks away from me. She fled, just bailed on me. Just on the battlefield, left me bleeding. To his credit, the Edge goes, great. Okay, that's how people look right before they call security. Back away from the Edge. And I heard what I said, and I'm like, God, dude, you're such a loser. And I pull myself to the side, and I'm like, geez, you're an idiot. And I'm sitting down on this case, just I'm like going, oh my God. And all of a sudden, Henry Winkler walks up to me. Do not ask him to go, hey. Don't do it. And for whatever reason, in this moment of feeling like crap, Henry Winkler's wife walks around him and goes, you're on that show, Big Shots. She liked Big Shots? She goes, oh my God, you were so funny on that show. What a good actor. It's so nice to meet you. Wow, pleasure, pleasure, pleasure. And now my inner retard is totally confused. What the hell has happened tonight? Did you step through a wormhole to a parallel universe where your doppelganger is popular? Yeah, well, I'd shut up if I was you, or you're gonna screw up a time-space continuum. I'm very smart for a retard. At least that's what Stephen Hawking says. At that point, Jackson Brown walks up to me. Yeah, my reason, do not speak to Jackson Brown. If you talk to Jackson Brown, I will cause an aneurysm and kill you myself. And I'm just freaking out. Like, I'm like, I can't maintain. I'm just shaking and I turn towards the wall. Hello, wall. Thank you, God. Oh, God. Oh, wall is good. Whew. At that point, the band gets off stage. Springsteen walks by, hugs the Edge, says something to him, says something to someone else, looks at me and goes, hey, Titus, I got a story for you, man. It's a long story. Nah, it's a short story. Nah, it's a long story. I'll see you in a minute. And he goes in his dressing room because he's all sweaty from the show, and he's wearing jeans and a t-shirt and a black vest, and he came out later all cleaned up perfect in jeans and a t-shirt and a black vest. I'm not kidding. And he goes, everybody, come in my dressing room, come on back. And we get to go into Bruce Springsteen's dressing room. And let me tell you something, I've been in show business a long time, and every dressing room I've ever been in, including the one here tonight, the best ones, are two steps above seventh grade boys' bathroom. It's just cinder blocks, a crappy rug, there's like a table with some wine on it, there's couches that, you know, groupies have done creepy stuff on. Oh, if I would have brought a black light in, everybody would have thrown up. And we're standing there, me and my girlfriend are standing there, and all of a sudden, Bruce Springsteen and Patti Springsteen start walking over to talk to us. And I realize I'm about to meet one of my heroes. Tell him what you did first. My buddy makes these rock and roll skull rings, so I got their ring sizes, and I had rings made for them because I want to be engaged to the Springsteens. Now tell him what else you did. I I wrote Bruce Springsteen a 3-page letter. Single-spaced. Do you see how sad they feel for you right now? And I give him the rings and I give him the letter and he goes, man, do you want me to read this right now? No, smartest move he made all night. And she starts talking, and they're the nicest people. By the way, Bruce Springsteen has so many douchebag credits, he could walk up to you on the street, punch you in the face as hard as he could, and you would go, I'm sorry. I don't know what I did, but I got to work on it because Tom Hanks punched me like 2 days ago. Just so you know, nicest guy in the world, most normal human being in the world, and his wife is even nicer. And she goes, I want you to know why you're here. Our son Evan got us into you, and we live in a very philosophical household. And she looks over at him, and I had this weird thought of what it must be like to be his kid. Because if you're a fan of The Boss, when he's doing those talks before he starts playing, you know, you're just inspired. You're like, yeah! But if you're his kid, that's just your dad, and he won't shut up. Like, would it be hard to live in that all the time, like on barbecue day at the house? You know, my dad used to barbecue chicken. And he used to flip that chicken with an American chicken spatula. But last year, the American chicken spatula company closed down. Now we got us these Chinese chicken spatulas. I don't know. Just ain't the same America anymore. Hey, can you give me some plates? I need 1, 2, 3, 4 plates. So that goes through my head. And then he starts talking. And just so you know, it's weird because he's just a normal human being. That's what I really got out of it. And he goes, you know, my kid Evan, right, would come home every night for dinner after school and just sit down quiet and wouldn't say much. Then after dinner, he'd go in his room and he'd watch something for hours. And frankly, I didn't want to know what the hell he was doing. But he did it every night, you know. He would actually be quiet at the table and then go in his room and just watch something. And after about 2 months, he came out of his room and he had these 2 box sets to your old TV show. And he held them up and he said, Dad, this show taught me a lot about life. I want you to watch it with me. And I say, And he goes, right? And it bugged me for a year because I'm like, what the? You know what it is? Is that I'm not the first person that couldn't speak English to him. So instead of having to say to everybody, what the fuck did you just say? He goes, right? And then you don't feel like an idiot. You're gonna read that goes, oh, I guess you said something coherent. Okay, okay. Just keep talking. What the hell? And so I don't say anything else. He keeps talking. And he just broke it down. He goes, you know what's really cool about that show? And I ain't a big fan of them sitcoms, man. But that one, I don't know. You had these horrible family stories, you know, and you made them funny. And then like about 2/3 of the way through, you would scare the hell out of everybody. And then you made that funny. And I don't know, man, it was like this roller coaster. And I ain't a big fan of them sitcoms, but that one, I don't know. It was kind of like art. And my inner retard's going, oh, this guy's an idiot, man. Oh, what is he talking about? I like John Cougar Mellencamp so much better than this guy. What an idiot. And I had this weird moment. Just a little tip, never have an epiphany in front of one of your heroes because I must have looked like I just spazzed. I had one brain going loser, other brain was going, what did he say? They're like, And I had this quick thought of in my life, I had never called myself a loser. No 5-year-old thinks that. I just believe what my dad said when he said it. And then when my ex-wife took it over, I guess my dad willed it to her when he died. I believed her too. And in this moment, when this man said this to me, I decided I will never again let these people define who I am. From now on, I will only let Bruce Springsteen define who I am. Yes! Yes! Because he's the boss! Because he's the boss! Don't clap, you do realize he's learned nothing from this, right? So we get done talking. They're very nice. And me and my girlfriend pull ourselves aside. They talk to other people. And here's the conversation my girlfriend and I have. I can't believe. And then all of a sudden, Jackson Brown is standing right here. And I don't hear the voice. When I was 16 years old, I came home, just in the middle of summer. And I came home, and I walked in my bedroom, and my father had installed 3-foot speakers, these badass speakers, on either side of my bed. And I knew aliens had kidnapped my dad and replaced him with someone who liked me. And he'd wired these speakers through the floor, under the house, to the front room in stereo. For the rest of that summer, all I did was turn that stereo up as loud as I could. It blew out the windows. AC/DC, you know, yeah, Beastie Boys, Journey, I apologize. What I didn't realize is school started in September. And what my father had actually done is install a 2,000-watt alarm system in my bedroom that he controlled from the front of the house. So from the first day of school that year till I graduated, my father woke my ass up at 6:45 with that stereo cranked up as loud as it would go and shot my ass to the ceiling to Jackson Brown's Running on Empty. Because he knew my grades and he thought that was ironically funny. So I tell Jackson Brown the Jackson Brown story. And had he stopped talking right there, this would be an amazing tale. But dumbass continues on and says one more sentence. I look Jackson Brown in the face, international superstar again, and I go, dude, that album and your music is kind of like a soundtrack to my life. And my girlfriend looks at me, turns, and walks away again. And here's when I realized that all these people we look up to, all these superstars we think are so cool, are just like us. Jackson Brown goes, man, I just wrote some songs. Wow, dude, why do you gotta make everybody feel creepy, man? Why? Why? You did it to everybody. You did it to the Boss, the Fonz, the Edge, now the Pretender. Good job, idiot. So now everybody's leaving the dressing room, and I don't want to be the last guy hanging out in the dressing room. I'm lying. I want to be the last guy in the dressing room. Bruce, Patty, everyone's gone. What do you say we get Snuggies and popcorn? What are you up for? I think better of it, though, and I go over to him, and I go, hey, man, I can't believe this happened tonight. Thank you so much. We're getting ready to go now, and I don't know. Would you sign something for me, man? And he goes, yeah, man, of course I will. And he grabs a set list up to the top of set lists. And this is what he writes on it. Chris, best. Thanks for the inspiration. Bruce Springsteen. And I walked out of there with the most beautiful woman in the world. And in the worst year of my life, I had the best night of my life. A month later, I'm pulling out of a car wash. Stay with me. I'm pulling out of this car wash and my phone rings and it says unknown. And I don't have any friends that are unknown. Hello? Hey, Titus, it's Bruce Springsteen. You can't call me, man. I told your wife, 3 people riddle and then you call. And he's laughing and I'm not laughing. And he goes, man, we just got back from Europe. It was insane, man. The fans over there are nuts. You won't believe it. I got sick, though. I lost 10 pounds in 2 days. It was insane. I had to cancel the show. I said, you canceled the show? He goes, I know, right? Because he knows who he is. And I don't think who I'm talking to. And I go, because he's so normal. I go, dude, isn't it weird when you're sick backstage? You got 102 temperature. You walk on that stage and all of a sudden, you're not sick anymore. You do this killer show. You walk back off and then you're dead again. And he goes, well, that's because of the audience, man. He goes, you were dead, right? But you walked out on that stage and they wanted to see that show. So they gave up their life to keep you going. And then you walked off and you were dead again because they weren't there to keep you alive. Yoda? And minor retard is screaming, you do know you're talking to the boss, right? And he just dropped the knowledge on your ass. And I start to panic again, and I go, so what'd you call? Which must have sounded like, yeah, blah, 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 Bruce, pick it up, pick it up. He's such a normal human, he goes, oh yeah, right. Like, I know you're washing your car, Titus, I'll let you get back to it. Idiot, what an idiot. He goes, the reason I'm calling, man, is he goes, we got back from tour, you know, and I remembered that you wrote me that letter, and I wanted to read it, and I was looking around the house for it, and I lost it. Oh, thank God. Oh, thank you, Lord in heaven. Because you know, when he found that letter, this would be a call from the FBI. Yeah, man, so I was wondering what that letter said. Damn it! All right, relax. It was 3 pages. Okay, tell him it said this. It said, first page said, thank. Second page said, you. Third page said, Bruce. And Patty, tell him that. But although this voice in my head ain't leaving, it ain't leaving none of us. You're gonna have it forever. I don't listen to mine anymore. And I told him what it said. It said, in 1985, I saw you at the Oakland Coliseum blow up 80,000 people. And I wasn't a fan. I was dating some girl that I was trying to sleep with. But I don't remember who that was now. But I remember that night, and I bought everything you'd ever done from that night and from that night forward. And I used to take your music on the road with me. And I would do these horrible gigs, and I'd listen to the music for hundreds and hundreds of hours, man, over and over. And these gigs were horrible, Bruce. I killed a baby once. And I'm laughing, and he's not laughing. And I quoted the lyrics. And the last paragraph said this. I didn't write this for me. I wrote this for the 25,000 people you played for tonight that are never going to be lucky enough to meet their hero and tell him what they meant to him. So for them, thank you. And he goes, wow, man, you know, that's really cool you did that. And had Bruce Springsteen stop talking right there. This would be a phenomenal story. But Bruce Springsteen continues on and says one more sentence. Man, I gotta ask you this. Did you really tell the Edge you bought his shirt?